In those days, you were traveling by public transport. You didn't have a car and a driver waiting for you to take you home. So I would be constantly looking at the watch. As long as it was 8, 9, I was fine. But after that, I would be, wondering, will I get the last train home? How do I get out of here?
How you made your journey through, ups and downs about your relationship with a star stardom. It kind of changed at times also. So there are two journeys. One is your personal journey of becoming a journalist and choosing entertainment of films as your area of work, and how you negotiated it with, say, the stars that you interviewed.
Right when I started out, the question that I was constantly asked was, why do you want to get into entertainment? It's just by default that I got into entertainment, actually. I kind of liked the whole ambience. And in those days, today's you have barely about 10 minutes, 15 minutes with the star. In those days, we would go to the sets and hang around the sets. You would wait. There would be sometimes, if you were lucky, you would get to sit in the makeup van. But sometimes you were on the set where it was really, really hot. And you would just sit and watch. You got the time with the star. This is, not just when he's shooting, but between shots, there would be lots and lots of people come to meet him, right? A writer wanting to narrate his story, to the producer wanting dates, to a director trying to cue him onto the next day's shoot or something like that. So you kind of got a kind of ringside view of the film industry while you waited to complete your interview. And as a result of which, I think because you were there, with the others, so the star also got to know you well. So your name rang a bell. Your face was easily recognizable even in a crowd. And there were times when this really helped. For instance, when there is a chapter where I say I started work on a new magazine called Zee Premier, and the magazine was not out on the stands. We didn't even know what was the name of the magazine, and I started going out and asking people for interviews. And the reason that I could get those interviews from whether it was Shah Rukh or Raveena or and they were all the top stars of the day was because they knew me. So they would laugh and say, "Oh, we are giving an interview for a magazine whose name we don't know," but they would give the interview.
How difficult was it to be a female, a young girl, running around for interviews? You have talked a little bit about it in your book, if you would like to know a little more about from you.
The difficulty was that if it got too late, in those days, you were traveling by public transport. You didn't have a car and a driver waiting for you to take you home. So I would be constantly looking at the watch. As long as it was 8, 9, I was fine. But after that, I would be, wondering, will I get the last train home? How do I get out of here? Those were the kind of things that, and again, in the Shah Rukh chapter, there is this bit about how I missed my last train and how he had his car drop me all the way to Vashi, and he took a ride with someone else. So
Yes.
these were little things that a lot of stars did then. They did it without anyone asking them. I know that once, this was much later. I think a couple of years ago, when I'd gone to meet Aamir, and we had finished around 11 o'clock, which is not that late in Mumbai. And he asked me, "How are you going home?" So I said, "No, I'm just going to catch a cab and go." And he says, "No, wait, my driver will take you home." So these are little things that a lot of them do.
Is in the introduction you mentioned about Lara Dutta showing you her ring and telling about her engagement and how she played along, and she helped you break a story. So in a world of social media now, where it's like the fastest finger first, how do you think journalism, especially entertainment journalism, has changed?
So I was editing Mumbai Mirror's entertainment section till December. And this is something that we addressed almost on a daily basis. Because of social media, even something like a casting coup, you didn't know whether it would be with you till the next day. Because, you were literally begging the producer that please don't put it out on the social media or stuff like that, you know. So it's got very, very difficult today. Keeping an exclusive, you know. I don't know if like Lara sat on it for 2 days. I don't know if we could sit on that for 2 days. But I know that there was an actress a year or two ago who had had a baby. And I had got to know she had had her baby on Thursday, and I was told about it on Friday and Saturday. No, I was told about it on Saturday, and Saturday was our day off. So the next day we didn't have that entertainment section in Mirror. It was a Sunday paper. So I said, look, I will not be able to carry the story. So they said, okay, how long can you wait? So I said, I'll have to wait and carry it Sunday for Monday. So this actress, she stayed in the hospital for 2 days, 3 days. It was a normal delivery, and normally you go home after 2 days. But she waited, and the paper came out on Monday morning, and around 11 o'clock she left the hospital. So you can still get your exclusives, but you have to have very good equation with the actor concerned. The paper should matter to them, that breaking this news in the paper, is it worth it or not? So that if you can convince your readers that I will always give you something exclusive, even if the news has come out, they will come back to you.
Over the years, there has been a lot of debate about the kind of representation that is correct, that should, and as close as Lakshmi Bomb, there was a controversy about whether the cisgender man should actually portray the role of a person from the community. So what is your understanding of this entire representation? What do you think, how it pans out, how it works?
The best thing about Indian cinema is that it addresses a large cross-section. So, you know, you have cinema for the teeny boppers of the 20s, as you say. You have something for the 30s, you have something for the 40s, you have 50s. And now I feel that with OTT, the section that was getting cut off, they are also coming into the mainstream now. Like today, if I were to make a film like Aligarh, having watched certain content on OTT, maybe the youngsters who earlier wouldn't have watched it, they would go and watch it today. So I think that's where we are going to score over the next 3-4. I mean, I see a lot of changes coming into mainstream cinema over the next 3-4 years. I feel that finally, you know, they say content is the king, content is the queen. And that has always happened with a kahani, a stray kahani. When they said Vidya Balan is the queen, you know, content is the queen. It happened with kahani, but I feel a lot more kahanis will get made today, because they're slowly, you know, people's minds are opening up to a variety of subjects. To the presentation is going to be different, you know. So the language of cinema is going to change. The presentation will be more gritty, more real. The characters will be more rounded and more fleshed out. And the stories will get better.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell icon so that you don't miss any videos by us.